morning, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. I was at the Wolfram Society meeting 2 years ago. And what I want to do in this talk is really, even if there's a varied audience today, is to go back to basics about how the eye can be affected in Wolfram syndrome. And although it's quite challenging to deal with this complication, I also mention some of the things that might be coming around the corner in terms of potential innovative treatment. I'm an ophthalmologist. Until very recently, I was based in Newcastle, but I moved to Cambridge earlier in the year, and I also have a special clinic at Moorfields in London, where I see a lot of patients with optic nerve problems, including patients with Wolfram syndrome. So what I'm going to do in the next 15 minutes or so is to go back to the basics. How do we see? How does the eye work? And how does it go wrong in Wolfram syndrome? And then also what I want to touch on very briefly is the eye test that you normally have done when you come to the eye department, because this is also relevant for people in the audience who might in the future be involved in clinical trials. And then lastly, this is the real challenge about how we can stop vision from getting worse in this genetic disorder. So if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to take it, and you know, if there's anything which isn't clear, please let me know. So how do we see? This is one of our most precious senses, because we all rely on it, something we take for granted until it starts to go wrong. So if you look at the eye here, which is just, I'm not sure whether there's a point, but I'll try. Nope. One. Right. What you see here is what you will see in the mirror. You have the lids, top and bottom, you have the white of the eye, and then you have the coloured part of the eye, which is known as the iris. And then the little hole in the middle is called a pupil, which is the aperture to which light goes into the back of the eye. And the second thing that you need is you need a lens. Right? And the reason why you need a lens is because you need something to focus the light from the front of the eye to the back of the eye. And at the back of the eye here, right, you have something called the retina. Right? And the retina is the sensitive layer that is going to convert light into an electrical signal. And I'm not going to go into the complexities of the retina, because it is quite a complex structure. But the point I'm trying to make is that there are a lot of cells in your retina, and not all of these cells are affected by Wolfram syndrome. There is a specific cell, which is known as the retinal ganglion cell, and that's the area where it gets damaged in this condition. And the reason why this is relevant is because these retinal ganglion cells have little outgrowths, and these little fibers converge the back of the eye to form a bundle, and this bundle is what we call as being the optic nerve. And when you're born, you have 1.2 million of these little cells. As we all grow older, we lose some of these cells, but in conditions like Wolfram syndrome, we lose these cells much more quickly. So the way I'm going to explain this to my patients in clinic is that the eye is a very sophisticated camera. And at the back of the brain here, you have an area which is known as the visual cortex. And the visual cortex gets all the information from the eye, processes it as a supercomputer, and gives you this impression of an image. But in between the eye and the brain, you need to have something which relays information quickly and efficiently. And this broadband cable is what we call the optic nerve. Right? So it's a very simple structure, right? The eye is a camera, the optic nerve to channel information, and then the visual cortex at the back of the brain as the processing computer. And when I have a look at the back of someone's eye, that's what I see here. You can see this little round circle here, which is golden yellow. This is what the optic nerve looks like in a normal, healthy individual. It has this golden yellow appearance. And then you can see all these blood vessels coming out, because obviously the retina, being quite active, needs a lot of blood and a lot of oxygen to work properly. The other area which is very important is something which is called the macula, because the reason why the macula is important is because this gives you your central vision, right? So if you look at someone's face, if you're reading, if you want to drive, you need very good central vision. And unfortunately, in a lot of genetic conditions, including Wolfram syndrome, it's the macula which gets affected first. And because of this, you end up losing that central part of your vision here. And this can be very debilitating, as you can imagine, because you can't make out people's features very clearly, you can't read very easily, and although your peripheral vision is normal, if your central vision is affected, this is a major handicap. So what type of eye problems do you get in Wolfram syndrome? Right? The main problem you get in Wolfram syndrome is that the retinal ganglion cells become damaged. And as these retinal ganglion cells become damaged, the optic nerve also becomes damaged eventually. So this is a paper published by Tim back in 1995 describing the clinical features that you get in Wolfram syndrome. And the two main features are diabetes and optic atrophy, which develop very early on in life. So what do I mean by optic atrophy? Because you will get copies of your letters from your doctors, and sometimes these terms can be quite, you know, obscure. So optic atrophy means that there has been damage to the optic nerve. And if you get damage to the optic nerve, instead of having this nice golden yellow appearance of the optic nerve becomes white in appearance. And this pallor of the optic nerve is what we call optic atrophy. We do know that vision gets progressively worse in Wolfram syndrome. And as I'm going to talk about some potential treatment coming around the corner, at this point in time, there is no treatment that we can do that can slow down the loss of these retinal ganglion cells and can stop the progression of loss of vision. If we look again at these guidelines that have been put together by the EuroWatt Consortium, you can see here again that these are two major criteria: diabetes and optic atrophy. And here the percentage of people with Wolfram syndrome that have optic atrophy is put at being 80%, but in my personal experience, you know, if you look very carefully, almost everyone will have some features of optic nerve damage. The other thing that can happen in some patients with Wolfram syndrome is not as common as optic nerve damage, is problems with your lens. So as I mentioned already, you need your lens to focus an image from the front of the eye to the back of the eye onto the retina. As we all grow older, our lens changes. So this is the lens of someone who's in their 20s, clear, transparent. As we grow older, the lens becomes thicker and it also becomes more yellow, right? And that's what people mean when you develop a cataract. So if we all get to a certain age, we will get cataract. This is an inevitable part of the normal aging process. But in the context of Wolfram syndrome, some patients can develop cataracts at a much younger age. And what happens is the image becomes much more blurry. So this is the image if you have a clear lens. This is the image as you start developing cataracts. So the image becomes more grainy, more blurry. And on top of that, if the optic nerve is affected, you can also lose your central vision. At least when it comes to cataract formation, Wolfram syndrome, it's not a major problem because nowadays with modern technology, cataract surgery is very safe. It takes less than half an hour to do, and this is something that can be offered if you have developed significant cataracts. So this is an example here of someone with cataract. The surgeon has done the operation, has replaced it with a new plastic lens, and it does the trick very nicely. So what are the eye tests that we do in the eye department to be able to monitor how the disease is progressing with time? So the first thing is to measure vision. You've all had this done at your opticians or in the eye department. You have the top letter here, which is 660 on the notation, and basically you get to read down the chart until you're not able to see the letters anymore. And very often, if you're coming for the first time, we'll also insist on using the optometrist because sometimes we can improve vision slightly with glasses. And the other thing that you will almost always have done if you come to see an eye doctor, they will put drops in to dilate your pupil. The drops do sting, it's not very nice, but the reason why we do this is so we can dilate your pupil. And by dilating your pupil, I can have a much better look at the back of the eye. And these are just the various instruments that we will use, doesn't really matter, but if you can see here that when I dilate your pupil, instead of being able to see this little part in the middle, I can see a lot more of the retina, and that can be very useful because, as you know, patients with Wolfram syndrome will also get diabetes, and we also need to make sure that there's no diabetic problem at the back of the eye. So the reason why we do all these tests is twofold. One is to check whether the optic nerve is normal, the structure of the optic nerve, and the second thing is how well you can see. Right. I won't go into the tiny details, but There's a lot of equipment we're going to get for an eye environment. And the reason for this is because this equipment allows us to image the back of the eye. And it's very good because, you know, it's non-invasive, no one's going to stick any needle in. You just sit down in a chair, put your chin on the chin rest, and then the technician will take the images. And almost all the clinical trials that are done these days will include this machine here, which is called an optical coherence tomography platform. And the reason why we do this is because the machine is able to scan the back of the eye, and we're able to measure the thickness of the optic nerve and the structure of the retina. I've already mentioned that we measure vision. On top of that, we also measure color vision. There are various ways of doing this. So most of the time, someone will open a book in front of you and ask you to read the numbers, and you count the numbers that you read properly. And this can be helpful because we do know that color vision is lost quite early when the optic nerve is damaged. It is probably a bit less sensitive when it comes to clinical trials, but it is something that is done routinely in my clinic, for example. The other thing which is very important is checking your visual field, right? So this can be a bit of a weird concept, right? And the best way to explain this is with our little friends here, the minions, right? So imagine if you cover one of your eyes, you only have one eye, right? How much can you see, right? In actual fact, you can see quite a lot with only one eye. You can see roughly around 150 degrees on the horizontal meridian, and you can see roughly around 120 degrees in the vertical meridian. And obviously, with both eyes open, your field of vision is much wider. And the whole point of checking your visual field is to check how much of the field has been damaged from the optic nerve becoming atrophic. There are various ways of doing this. It's named after the people who've come up with the machine, so Mr. Goldman and Mr. Humphrey. It doesn't really matter. There's the same job in terms of getting the field of the visual field damage. But I just want to show you roughly what it tells us. So this is a patient here with optic atrophy, and you can see here that right in the middle there's an area in black where when the patient can't see very well, right? And this is the central scotoma I mentioned a bit earlier in my talk. And if you relate that to a real life event, so if you put that in front of a picture, for example, you can see here how you lose your central 20 degrees of vision. And the next thing that we will sometimes do, and not routinely, is to measure how quickly the image is being transmitted from the eye to the back of the brain. And this is called visual electrophysiology, right? And if your optic nerve is damaged, right, in Wolfram syndrome and other genetic conditions, what happens is that the electrical signal is delayed, right? The technology behind this doesn't really matter, but what the way that we do this is you sit down in front of a big screen, and then there is a little pattern. Very often, these are little checkerboards or little hexagons there. And what the pattern does, it gives us an indication of how quickly the signal goes from the eye to the back of the brain. And the delay or the loss of the signal gives us an indication of the damage to the optic nerve. I think the other thing also which is quite important is, although treatment is limited, one of the things which is very important to do in the clinic, and sometimes people forget because clinics are very busy, is to check whether or not someone is eligible to be registered as being severely visually impaired, because this will then put you to the relevant service. And certainly for children is very important because in the schooling we have to be adapted accordingly. So there are two ways of classifying this so-called visual registration, which is based on your level of vision. So there are two of them. One is sight impaired, which used to be called as being partially sighted, and then severely sight impaired, which used to be called as being blind, which is a bad term because no one becomes blind really from this condition. And as I mentioned already, if you look at the traditional chart here, 660 is a top letter on the vision chart. And for you to be registered as being severely sight impaired, your vision must be worse than 360. For you to be registered as being sight impaired, there's a bit more flexibility here, but generally speaking, your vision would be worse than 660, meaning that you can't see the top letter on the vision chart at a distance of 6 meters. And then nowadays, what's quite relevant is putting patients in touch with the relevant service in the low vision clinic, and this is very helpful in terms of adaptation, especially in the early stages of the disease process. I think the final few slides will be really about what's coming around the corner. I heard already this morning about treatment that is being developed drug tablets to try and slow down the process. The team will be starting trials very soon. There's also trials running in the US. So the aim is really to stop you losing your retinal ganglion cells. Because if we can stop it, the good thing is that these cells get lost very slowly with time. So there is a window of opportunity, right? So this is one thing which I want to discuss, because this has been covered already in the first session. But the one thing which I want to mention is whether or not there is scope for other forms of intervention to try and rescue the optic nerve. There's no doubt that this will be challenging, because I also do research not just on Wolfram syndrome, but on other genetic conditions that affect the optic nerve. And things are moving slowly. But for example, for a different condition called Leber's optic neuropathy, which is a mitochondrial disease, we've just completed a gene therapy trial at Moorfield. So, you know, technology and science moves forward, and we should be optimistic about the future. The reason why Wolfram syndrome could be a good target for gene therapy is because in this disorder, as you know yourself, the gene is mutated, and because the gene is mutated, very often you lose the protein, right? So if there's a way of replacing the gene and replacing the missing protein, there's no reason why this would be useful in terms of stopping the disease in its track. This is a picture of the late Christian Mel. A lot of you in the audience will know him. He was a good friend and a fantastic scientist based in Montpellier in France. He passed away recently, unfortunately. But his group in Montpellier has really been the one, you know, taking the lead in terms of developing gene therapy for Wolfram syndrome. And the way that we do this, and the reason why it's been always been very attractive, is because when it comes to the eye, the advantage we have is that we have easy access, right? So not only squirmish, but every day in your average clinic, we inject things in the eye for diabetes, for macular degeneration. So it's something we do very routinely. And the reason why also it's a very helpful strategy is if we inject a drug into the eye, it gets to the retina and gets to the eye very quickly. So we don't have any barrier to the drug that we want to get in the right place. I'm not going to go into the science, but it's quite complex. But if your aim is to replace a gene, right, two things must happen. One, there must be a way of putting the gene in the cell. And the second thing, there must be a way of controlling the expression of the gene so that it works at the right level. Not enough causes disease, but also too much can also cause disease. So we need to regulate the level. So the science is complex, but people have made a lot of advances. And there are a lot of different viruses that you can use. And these are not going to cause disease, because these viruses have been deactivated, right? We're only using them to get access to the cell. And in terms of gene therapy for the eye, the one that we tend to use is something called AAV2. It doesn't really matter, but just in case you read about this, this is a specific virus that has a very good way of penetrating the cells in the eye. And to be able to test this treatment, the first thing you need to have a good model. And again, the group in Montpellier have a mouse model of Wolfram syndrome, and the mice have mutations in the WFS1 gene. And because they have mutations in that gene, they develop loss of vision, and the optic nerve gets damaged. So you have a good model, and then you can find ways of rescuing the damage. And they've done that. So essentially, recently, Cecile Direct has presented some of her results, and at least in their mice, by injecting the gene vector, they're able to stop the damage to the optic nerve, and the mice have better vision than if they had not been treated. So this is very useful, very positive, very very promising for the future. But at the same time, we need to realize that there's a big step moving from a mouse model to a human model. And further work needs to be done, not only about the safety of the vector, but also about the best way to inject it and when to inject it, because we know that the disease starts very early on. So this is something that I'm hoping they will be moving forward, because I think it's a very attractive strategy when it comes to preventing visual loss with the optic nerve involvement in Wolfram syndrome. So really, I think, you know, it's quite clear that this is a major worry for a lot of patients and their families, because visual loss is a central component of the disease. It is something that unfortunately will gradually get worse with time. And unfortunately, at this point in time, we can offer some palliative treatment to try and improve someone's vision, but we can't stop it. That's the reality at this point in time. But the hope is that either with drugs or with gene therapy, we might be heading in the right direction. I think it's very important for patients to have an eye check with an ophthalmologist in the hospital, because there is equipment that we have access to that others don't, right? There's a lot of pressure on the service, so I suspect 12 to 18 months is a reasonable gap in between. And finally, something that you should ask your eye doctor to do for if it's not been done before. If you feel that your child or someone in the family is eligible to be registered as being visually impaired, I think you should do that, because sometimes people forget. And finally, you know, gene therapy is a promising target, but it's a very early stage and more work needs to be done. Thank you very much.